7 generations ago, our forebears took the rock from the very ground we're standing on, molded its clay and water into bricks, and raised up a fabulous structure. Its like will never be seen again. It is absolutely priceless and totally irreplaceable. One voice. We have to say it, repeat it, don't tear it down. Don't tear it down. Don't tear it down. Don't tear it down.
Thank you all for coming this evening and testing the capacity of the lecture room at the Morbid Anatomy Museum. Recently, in the wake of the needless and highly contested demolition of Greystone Park State Asylum, a national organization has emerged to advocate the preservation and adaptive reuse of the remaining Kirkbride hospitals. I'm delighted to be spokesperson and a founding trustee for Preservation Works. We're committed to preserving Kirkbride Plan hospitals by sharing knowledge and resources to support local efforts and educate the public on the historic and global significance of these irreplaceable structures. This was the brainchild of President Christian Van Antwerpen, and connected all of these different communities that had previously been working in isolation, trying to protect their local building.
Okay, I'll meet kind of in this first area here, just to make sure we get a head count. So, everybody, wander on out, have fun. So, Preservation Works kicked off around April of 2015, and at that point in time, demolition work had already started at Greystone. And one of the first things that we did was we started figuring out ways to partner with Preserve Greystone, and we started a national rallies for Greystone, where we had people standing in front of different Kirkbrides throughout the country. And through the process of working with the Preserve Greystone people, and specifically with John Huebner, we started having conversations of what would happen to the legacy of Preserve Greystone. And it was a conversation that neither of us really wanted to have.
Once the building was gone, there was really no purpose for us to continue as an organization. We were founded with the express purpose of an adaptive reuse of this particular building. Like any entity that dies, there's the process of passing on your assets.
And at that point, he had offered to provide us with some resources, and we were just a baby organization. We were just an idea.
Our last act as Preserve Greystone was to, for all of us on the Board of Trustees, to sign a document that said essentially, henceforth, this organization shall be known as Preservation Works. The bylaws will be as follows, and they are essentially Preservation Works bylaws. Preservation Works was such an obvious heir to our organization that it gave people who were really impassioned over the efforts to preserve Greystone, to reuse the building, some place to go and some place to continue the efforts. They didn't have to stop. There was so much momentum built at that point that it would have been a terrible tragedy on a personal level for a lot of people who were involved to just have to stop.
He wanted the legacy of Greystone to be carried out through Preservation Works by allowing us to carry out their 501c3 status. We basically humbly accepted the awesome responsibility of becoming what Preserve Greystone was, but on a national level with all the remaining Kirkbrides, with the full backing, support, and resources of what was Preserve Greystone.
We were really fortunate that we had so much support from the community. We won't build a building like this again. It's the case with almost all of the Kirkbrides. The materials that they used to build those buildings and the artisans who built those buildings are long gone. We'll never see buildings like this constructed again. And for that reason alone, they're worthy of preservation.
I've seen pictures of Traverse City all renovated, looking good as new, full of people, alive again, and vibrant, and I know that that could have been Greystone. And it's surreal. It's really surreal to look at those pictures and to realize that that is a reality. But it's very poignant too, because it's never going to happen here in New Jersey. It's too late.
In the summer of 2013, I actually did get to attend a Chris Christie press conference right here in Parsippany, and I did get to ask him the question, given the history of that building and given the tremendous outpouring of support, would the administration ever consider reconsidering their decisions about Greystone and at least put out a request for proposal? And he gave me a one-word answer. He looked me straight in the eye and said, no. Next question.
Well, I'm concerned about the way that the Greystone decisions were made. Democracy is governed by the people, so the people really need to know everything that's going on. That's why we have sunshine laws, and that's why everything should be open. Politics of government is not always in the best interest of the public. This is not just skepticism. My knowledge of how government works. You can't really trust government to do the right thing.
People ask us from time to time about the Kirkbride facility in their town or their city. I would say a place like Greystone, it was all about having a vision and imagination. It sounds like people were not able to reimagine Greystone as being used for other things. I mean, it was a huge investment by our state, Greystone by a huge investment by the state of New Jersey to create a place to help people get better. All these Kirkbrides were meant to be there for hundreds of years. We don't build stuff like that anymore.
There are a number of reasons why Kirkbrides are worth preserving and adaptively reusing them. On one level, the materials they are made from, much of those materials are irreplaceable. On the fabrication skills that each building embodies uniquely, of local materials, of local craftsmanship, those skills are embedded in the buildings and are, in many cases, irreproducible.
Mr. Seidemann Aristoff, the treasurer of the state of New Jersey, told me to my face that he would not go into detail as to what informed his decision to go ahead and demolish the building. There was an awful lot of opportunity lost. First and foremost, and maybe the most difficult to quantify, is the sense of redemption that would have come from taking something that was such a huge presence in the community for so long and to turn it into something useful would have been very uplifting, I think, for everyone. Unfortunately, what we got instead is a continuation and a reinforcement of the stigma that still attaches to mental illness in this country and to the scandal that went along with Greystone. That was a huge opportunity missed. You know, sweeping that under the rug, or in this case, the lawn, is a huge opportunity missed here.
The last efforts to preserve Greystone was just after the first national conference called Preservation Works that Christian Van Antwerpen organized out in Traverse City. And the reason we went to Traverse City was to look at a successful example, to bring together people from different communities and show everybody successful examples of what could be if you have an imagination.
We would not exist with the level of potency that we have as a national organization if Greystone hadn't fallen, if Greystone hadn't had that fight and loss, because now we know how important it is.